friends, we have with us today Dr. Indu Bhushan, CEO Ayushman Bharat. So he's the man of the moment right now. The scheme was launched, formally launched last Sunday, and there's been a lot of buzz about it. So the way we do this is, if you have some opening remarks, you make them, and then we throw the floor open for questions.
So thank you very much, Avantika, for inviting me.
In a way, government is instituted a price assurance mechanism for private hospitals. Mm-hmm. So what you are framing it as a demand side intervention, I'm saying it could also be read as a price assurance to hospitals. So don't you think this is a very counterproductive approach, rather than investing this much money in enhancing your private facility, in enhancing health services facility, rather you are asking private, I'll pay you. So you are subsidizing private players.
And sir, to add to that question, then Swasthya Abhiyan recently said that this is actually based on a failed, discredited RSBY model. They have a similar kind of argument.
Well, what is wrong in providing resources to private sector to ensure services for the poor? Either you tell me, give me a model where we can ensure services to the poor from public sector. We've tried that for the last 70 years. So now what we're saying is that poor people will also have that option of going to private providers. Of course, they can go to public provider as well. They're going there anyway. And we'll pay private providers only if they cater to these people. So this money is not like we're not giving the money away to private sector unconditionally. It's conditional on they serving the poor. So in that sense, I think it's a scheme with a very far-reaching impact, because what will happen with this scheme is that we'll change the incentive structure in private sector as well as in public sector. Because right now the incentive structure is to provide services to those people who can afford it, but now we have increased the affordability of these people as well, so they will, private sector will cover them. Also, if you look at the distribution of private sector facilities, right now more than 50% of the private sector facilities are concentrated in top 20 cities. And the reason is that that's where the paying capacity is. Now, it's a chicken egg situation, because tier 2, tier 3 cities, rural areas, we don't have quality private sector facilities because there's no paying capacity. Since there's no paying capacity, there's no health facility. So this scheme tries to break that vicious circle and provides incentive for private sector to expand to these places where they've not seen, they've not been, because of lack of business opportunities. They'll go there. Even for public sector, it changes the incentive structure, and now public sector earlier could provide services to anyone, and now of course they'll provide services to anyone even now, but for them these are VIPs, because they will bring rupees with them which can be used and for both incentive for the doctors and other paramedical workers, but as well as provide resources for upgrading facilities in the hospitals in public sector.
For a layman, there seems to be a contradiction in the whole scheme, because your target group area which you are trying to reach are the dispossessed in rural areas in the far outskirts. Now we know for a fact that there are no hospitals over there, neither of the private nor of the public. There's no public health care. So to a layman, it looks as if the first priority should have been setting up health care centers in the rural areas before going into this, because how does it really work? You're saying it's a chicken and an egg situation, but we see that, for example, in a hospital like Ames, people are coming not just from villages, they're coming from towns in the whole of North India, because obviously they're not getting proper medical thing. So how is this going to work?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so this scheme is not taking away from anything else that government is doing right now and has done for last 70 years. And as I was saying, that for last 70 years, our focus has been in terms of providing or strengthening services, both in urban areas and mostly actually in rural areas. If you look at our distribution of public health services or public hospitals, it's largely skewed towards rural areas. It's not there in top 20 cities. But the issue has been that this strengthening of public services, public hospitals, has not benefited the poor people because of their lack of bargaining power, the lack of this extreme inequities that we have in terms of their social access to these facilities. Now, this scheme provides them that access. Now, you're right that we need to strengthen public services outside these big cities, outside Delhi, Mumbai and other places. But how do you do that? You can either do that by following the previous approach where we provide services, but assumption that if you provide services, they'll come, will not happen. Now, you're providing incentive, providing huge market for private sector.
Sir, following that question, there are not enough private hospitals, even in big cities outside of Delhi, but Delhi is not a part of your scheme, and for thousands of people, Delhi is still the place to come to. So, you know, isn't it like a deal breaker for the scheme not to have Delhi on?
Yeah, see, not having Delhi as part of our scheme has been a bit of a letdown, because you're right, because Delhi, a lot of people actually living in Delhi actually belong to areas around Delhi. They're not from Delhi and they're part of our scheme. And for them not to have impaneled hospitals in Delhi will be a problem. To address that, what we've done is we have impaneled ourselves three major hospitals, AIIMS, RML and Safdarjung Hospital. And we're also looking at the possibility of impaneling other hospitals, because there are more than 500 hospitals from Delhi who have shown keenness to be part of our scheme. So we are looking at various options, how we get these hospitals on board. But I'm also still hoping, and I believe that Delhi should also come on board soon. Mm-hmm. Well, one problem with Delhi has been the lack of communication, because we've not been able to get communication directly from the political leadership. At the bureaucratic level, whenever we've spoken to the chief secretary or health secretary, we've seen the willingness to join. But somehow they send an offer, we make some changes, and it goes back and it never comes back, and without and we don't get the reason why they're not doing it.
So there's this one question about the scheme repeatedly asked, and we always struggle to explain it. Government hospitals give services for free. Mm-hmm. 5 rupees, 10 rupees registration fee, that's all. What are they being paid for, and if they are being paid for, is there a timeline where you're looking at phasing out government support to these hospitals and make them self-sustaining? What is exactly the plan there?
Okay. You're right that in most places, government services are free, but not all services are free. In most cases, or many cases, you have to still pay for implants or the things that you need to buy from outside. So this scheme will actually ensure three things in public sector. One is that it will be completely free, so all this, there will not be any excuse that we have run out of these schemes or these medicines or these implants or these other things that you need to go and buy out yourself, because they're getting money, it will be all paid for. Second is that in public hospitals, usually they don't have many facilities, like diagnostics will not be there, they may not have MRI. So this scheme allows them to have this public-private partnership where they can use the money that they're receiving from us to contract out a few things that can be, so they can provide that holistic support.
A lot of for a lot of consumers of this service, it will be people who will be using insurance for the first time, and even people in urban areas struggle how to negotiate with a TPA desk and all those kind of things. So it requires a very easy to use for a rural India or a small towns where people are going to avail these benefits. It will require a huge IT way of handling things. The things are claims are processed fast. Otherwise, if they have to bring money before getting admitted, so for that they already borrowed it. So then that usury and that cycle they are trapped in, because that money gets spent anyway. So it will serve its purpose if when they reach the desk, they don't need to bring cash. So for that you need a huge IT backup. So how are you dealing in remote India or small towns where bandwidths are poor, people may not be equipped, small hospitals and private hospitals may not be IT, they'll not be well versed with how to deal with these systems. So that is a much bigger challenge in rolling out. And are you facing it, and how are you dealing with it?
We are facilitating this through a strong IT backbone, and so all our hospitals right now that we've impaneled are connected through this IT backbone. And it was a pleasant surprise for me that most of the district hospitals and most of the private hospitals that we've come, and most, I'd say more than 99%, don't have the problem with connectivity right now. I think this is part of changes that have happened in India in the last few years. There are some districts in Northeast and where connectivity is a problem, and we have offline module that can be used for those. But for 99% or even more hospitals, connectivity is not a problem, and I think our IT system has been working quite well even in remote areas of Chhattisgarh. So luckily, or there are only few states who've gone for an insurance model where insurance company has come in and providing cover. In most cases, and especially in all the bigger and poorer states, we are following what is trust model. So government is paying the claims, and so far the problem has not been there. And we actually have benefited from the earlier scheme, this RSBY, Rashtriya Swasthya Bima Yojana, which was piloted or which was done in many states. Almost all of the states had some experience of RSBY, so that has helped in terms of I think improving the understanding of how this demand side financing works.
So in your first few meetings with insurance companies, they have said that this premium amount is too low.
Mm-hmm.
So why are so many states going on trust? Is that because insurance companies are unwilling to come on board?
Not at all. Actually, insurance companies were never willing or never unwilling to come on board. But and also we had not specified any insurance premium. We had said that the premium will be discovered through market forces and through bidding, open bidding. And we've seen a huge variance in terms of premium quoted. For example, Nagaland is 444 rupees per family, whereas we've seen 1600 in some other provinces.
But in the states which are going on insurance, I believe J&K and Pondicherry are going on insurance with insurance companies. So what is the premium there?
J&K has got 775 per family. Pondicherry, I think they have not opened the bid yet. So 775 is actually, we didn't specify 775, it was discovered through this open bidding.
So now that the scheme is rolled out, do we have a realistic estimate of how much it's going to cost? Because Jean Drèze says it will cost 50,000 crore per year.
And he bases that based on the calculation that if every family uses 1% of 5 lakhs, then it will be 50,000 crores. Now, this 1% is just a number that he has assumed. If it assumed 2%, probably it will be 100,000 crores, right? But better way of looking at how much it will cost is either you can do it from study of what is the healthcare seeking behavior now, and or what has been the premium which has been discovered through market. So on the first thing, if you look at the healthcare seeking behavior, in the beginning I had said that right now bottom 20% hospitalization rate is 2%, and so for 2% means that 50 crore people, 1 crore people will be hospitalized in a year, and per hospitalization expenses are 8 to 10,000 rupees. So from that it will be 10,000 crores. But of course, as the scheme becomes more mainstreamed and becomes deeper, we'll expect that this 2% will increase to 3%, 4%, but that will take some time. When it becomes 4%, of course, it will go to 20,000 crores. So our initial estimate has been based on that, and it's about 10,000 crores.
I think Chhattisgarh has a hybrid model where
up to 50,000 is in insurance and the rest is under assurance model. So for 50,000, I think they got a quotation of about 1,100 rupees from insurance companies. So why such variation? Like we are seeing for only 50,000, 1,100 rupees.
You know, Chhattisgarh has been a state, I think in some ways, where probably the whole of India will move, because they have a very well-running scheme right now, and it's been running for a long time now. So when and that's what we are expecting with this scheme as well, that when we have experience and problems you raise, that when both on demand side and supply side people are more used to this scheme, the hospitalization date will go up, people will, instead of coming later, will come be coming earlier in the disease process. So Chhattisgarh actually has also like we've started the launch the thing right now. Large proportion of our hospitalization are coming from Chhattisgarh, and they have a so well running scheme. People know about the scheme, and people would come in large numbers for hospitalization. So, but that is not the case, for example, right now in UP, Bihar and MP, where they're implementing a scheme like this for the first time.
Sir, out of 31 states which are on board, how many are on assurance and how many are in hybrid and how many are purely in insurance
model? Okay, so 18 are on trust, and then we have 7 on insurance mode, and the remaining are on mixed mode, hybrid mode.
Have you figured out why this majority of states are preferring this trust model? Mm-hmm. Because in the long term, assuming that this scheme is going to last longer than our lives, in the long term, it has a fiscal bearing on states. We know the heated debates in UK, we know the debates on insurance worldwide. So are these states being short-sighted? Have they figured out why that long-term implications or the fiscal implication of the move that they have made right now?
You know, let me clarify that in terms of the fiscal impact, in terms of the outflow of the funds, it doesn't really matter whether you're doing through trust mode or through insurance mode. And in some ways, probably you'll have to pay more if you are following insurance mode, because you'll have to also pay for the administrative cost and the profit of the insurance company. And of course, insurance company will bring in some efficiency, and that will probably reduce some of that, those cost and expenses. But if you look around the world, everywhere except maybe a few countries like Colombia and Mexico, the mass health insurance companies are implemented through trust. Now, your basic question that why have states chosen to go with the trust model, you know, it was a surprise for me as well. When I joined about 5 months ago, at that time, when I had discussion with all the states, almost all of them, except a few, were going for insurance mode. But a few things happened. They also looked around and seen that what has worked in the country. And they were very impressed with the model of, say, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, where trust was actually doing very well. And second was that they realized that trust also provides them more flexibility. Because in the insurance mode, once you've decided the benefit package and you have a contract with the insurance company, you are stuck because you can't, say, include one more health condition or change any other package because that has implications for cost. And
the success of the schemes, most of the schemes like Ayushman Bharat depends upon data, what you have. But in most of the poor states, you know, there is there is gross under-reporting of illness that happens. And most of them don't even figure in NSSO or, you know, HMIS. So does the government expect an explosion of demand when in future?
I am 100% sure that there will be explosion of demand, and that will be the success of the scheme. Because if you've seen the NSSO data, you'll find a very ironic inverse correlation between health and proportion of people who are ailing. And all those healthy states where IMR is very low and all the health indicators are good, proportion of people who claim to be sick are high. And so it's not that these people actually indeed have higher proportion of people who are sick, but I think they're more aware and they're reporting it better. In states with very high infant mortality, you'll find that reported sickness is low. So it's again the problem with reporting rather than the fact. So with this scheme, we should be seeing that reversal of the trend, that if unhealthy state or unhealthy areas should be reporting higher level of sickness. And so because, like I was saying, that we are connecting the whole country with a IT backbone, this will also help us identify what's happening in terms of disease patterns and what kind of health conditions are concentrated where. And actually, this can have a lot of good public policy impact. If we find that anemia is prevalent in certain belt, or then we can also have public policy interventions there.
So my question is regarding, you know, universal health coverage. The Delhi Chief Minister and the Delhi Health Minister have said, you know, if you look at Delhi per se, not more than 6 lakh people will gain from the scheme if it is implemented in the city. You know, the fact that firstly that, you know, it has to be that there has to be an hospitalization, that you completely ignore preventive and private healthcare. And secondly, that, you know, it doesn't include like diagnostic tests and all of that sort, that you have to get hospitalized. And second, that coverage, that only 6 lakh people in Delhi will actually, you know, benefit in comparison to the present Delhi government scheme, which has both you, if you are a citizen of Delhi and if you have the Aadhaar card or the PAN card, you can get a number of tests. You need not get hospitalized. And secondly, that, you know, you don't have an income limit here. You know, how would you address that issue?
You know, this is not unique to Delhi, this kind of situation. We have many other states where other schemes are going, which are much broader. And we found a way to converge our scheme with their scheme. For example, even in Jharkhand, where we launched this scheme, we are supporting about 27 lakh families, whereas the total number of families being covered by the government is more than 50 lakhs. So that doesn't mean that we are not adding value. In Delhi, we'll add value in a huge way if Delhi decides to come on board. One will be through national portability, because right now, like earlier Avantika mentioned, that lot of people come to Delhi for services because Delhi is a hub for providing these services. So all these hospitals actually will gain a lot by treating all these people from outside, and that will help. Also, in terms of ensuring this portability, ensuring that seamless portability, like people come to Delhi, if they fall sick, they should be able to get services. Right now, Delhi's scheme is not going to help people who are coming from outside, right? And so that would have been, and also Delhi people also go out. When they go out, they'll not get services outside if Delhi is not part of our scheme. So Delhi can keep its coverage for outpatient and other things. At the same time, they can join, and they will actually also receive resources, because for these 6 lakh families that we have, it may be small, but we will still give resources. And my estimate was that Delhi is foregoing about 15 crores rupees every year by not joining. In addition, the hospitals in Delhi are foregoing a lot of income that they would have generated by treating patients from outside Delhi. So, of course, universal health care coverage is the goal, and everyone should be covered, but this is just a beginning. And so ultimately, we have to have a universal coverage where we can ensure that rich people subsidize poor people, healthy people subsidize unhealthy people, and young people subsidize the old elderly. So that kind of a social compact will come only when we have universal health coverage. But again, this is a huge leap. I won't say a step, it's a huge leap towards that goal.
So my follow-up question is regarding hospitalization. This scheme inherently, you know, encourages that people have to get hospitalized, you know, to access the scheme. On one side, you have government hospitals. Let's take the top 3 hospitals in Delhi, AIIMS, Safdarjung, or Lady Harding, where the occupancy rates for your IPD, which is the hospitalization, is more than 150%. Okay, and let's take the private hospitals. You know, so where the occupancy rates are not high, but this scheme ensures that, you know, hospitalization is a must. So a person who doesn't have an insurance scheme, which is the government scheme, you know, but the model is created in such a way that the hospitals now, or the doctors will tell, you know, get hospitalized even for a small treatment. And even a person who doesn't have access to it, you know, now has to pay extra money. How do you think you will be able to handle this sort of, you know, the new change that will come up?
While I was saying that hospitalization is needed for seeking benefits, but we have certain packages where daycare is also, like dialysis being one of them. It doesn't require hospitalization, and so those daycare packages are also there. But you're right that there may be a perverse incentive here in terms of pushing people for hospitalization, and we would count that maybe borderline fraud, if not fraud, abuse for sure.
One thing you said in the course of interaction is how this entire system will also help you detect public health situations emerging. But for that, you need to have a more data in that sense. So that means the system will be capturing more data. So not only the payment of a transaction, so the service rendered for a 2 days hospitalization, and then you're also recording the what ailment he is going. So in a person, it's a breach of privacy also, because somebody, and you may need it, as you may justifiably say, so that I need it to verify whether for fraud detection or not. Public health, you can take an excuse that you can do it from the metadata. I'm not looking at individual, but a number of cases which are TB, or a number of cases which are something else. So those kind of things you can do, but for that your system will be capturing the ailments attached to every individual. So it opens up a very gray zone in a long term. Probably Indian society is still just rising up on this occasion with the right to privacy from last year. But this is going to be a very big gray area. How are you going to tackle the data and its privacy for a long term for every individual?
Well, you know, you're absolutely right, because we are dealing with two very sensitive pieces of information. One is their health record or health conditions. Second is their personal data, including Aadhaar. So we've been extremely careful in terms of ensuring that we have the follow the highest standards for maintaining privacy and security. So we have I think I'm right in saying that we are the first program in the Ministry of Health which has its own privacy and security policy, and which is based on ISO 27001 and all the international best practices. So in terms of security, we followed more than 100 controls to ensure that any data that we receive is received in a transparent fashion and stored and used very carefully. And none of the data that we don't need is destroyed and is not stored with us. And also ensure that no one can get access to it without the proper consent of the patients themselves. And we'll not be using or we'll not be sharing this data with anyone, of course, outside the country, but also outside NHA without any very specific reason.
Sir, why it is taking so much time to identify the scheme beneficiaries? Is lack of awareness or lack of efforts by the states? They're automatically included in the scheme, but the beneficiaries need to be identified so that they take advantage of the scheme.
I think it's not taken that long, because you know we have more than 10 crore families, and we have identified more than about almost 10 crore families, and they know it. And since the launch of the day, every day on our website, which is called merapmj.gov.in, so far we've had more than 12 lakh hits, where people have spent about five to six minutes to look at the names.
So one last question. Mm-hmm. One sentence that all of us health reporters learn from the moment we enter the book is that India should increase its health spend to 2.5% of GDP. Mm-hmm. And that's been, I think, for the last two decades, that's been the case. Mm-hmm. And now the elders also recommended the same, mm-hmm. even though they say this is a good scheme and UHC and all that. Mm-hmm. So when do you see that happening?
Well, I hope by 2025, but the challenge has been that we've been growing by 6 to 7%, 8%. So even when we increase our budget by 6 to 8%, we still stay the same,
yeah.
Because our pie is growing. So to double from 1.2 to 2.5, we need to grow by about 20%. The health sector budget needs to go by 20%. And I think more than the budget, I think it's the absorptive capacity, right? If we have such a large increase in budget, whether we can absorb it, that has been probably one of the challenges.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for coming here.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me here.